Thank you. Good morning, everyone. Welcome to worship. I'm Pastor Haley Vay Beeman, and I'm so glad that you're here this morning. We celebrate Father's Day. Happy Father's Day to all the fathers and father figures in our lives. We give thanks to God for you. And we'll have a special photo presentation in your honor a little later in our worship this morning. A small note about that, if you send in photo descriptions along with your pictures, we were not able to use them in this presentation, but I really enjoyed reading those captions that went with each photo. And thank you all so much for participating in this project. If you're worshiping with us for the first time today, we especially welcome you. Please let us know in the comments or by sending a direct message through our ULC Facebook page. We'd appreciate knowing you're here and being able to connect with you. Immediately after worship, we host a Zoom coffee hour. You're welcome to join by clicking the Zoom link in our weekly announcements email, which was sent on Friday. This weekend, we celebrate Juneteenth in solidarity with our siblings of African descent. Juneteenth is a freedom celebration that commemorates June 19, 1865, when slaves were finally delivered their freedom. It matters to us as the church because freedom is the love language of Jesus Christ. There's much more to that story that we'll share in the context of worship today, but I'd encourage you to do your own research to learn more. There are great resources available through the Lansing Juneteenth celebration online and on our ELCA.org website, where you can learn more about the African Descent Lutheran Association. So as part of that introduction, I wanted to share some background with you in this short video on the history of Juneteenth.
June 19th is also known as the holiday Juneteenth. It is the oldest known celebration to honor the end of slavery in the United States. The holiday is most often celebrated in African American families or communities. Today, with computers and smartphones, news travels instantly. But after the Civil War, the Emancipation Proclamation had to be carried from place to place and read aloud. That was the document issued by President Abraham Lincoln to say that enslaved people in the South must be set free. It took 2.5 years for news of freedom to reach enslaved people living in Texas. On June 19, 1865, they finally got the word. They were free. Jubilation, joyful celebrations broke out in places where the Emancipation Proclamation was read, and that was the start of today's Juneteenth traditions. People share stories of that great day, have picnics, attend rodeos and baseball games, go fishing, and have fun with family and friends. Juneteenth is also a time to learn and celebrate new things. Many museums offer Juneteenth programs and exhibits. Although the holiday has its roots in Texas, it shows appreciation for African American history and culture, and for the freedom of people everywhere. What would your Juneteenth celebration be like?
As we continue our sermon series on the book of Job, I invite you to join me in our call to worship. With Job of old, we cry out, everywhere the innocent suffer. Our desires and efforts achieve us little. O God, are you good, yet you do nothing to help us? Our answers have holes, and we fall through. Hear us, O God. Hear us, O God. Revive us with hope. Revive us with hope. Give us your life. Give us your life. Hear these words and receive their power. The majesty of God the Father undergirds all that is. The mercy of God the Son accepts our despair. The comfort of God the Spirit embraces us in communities of care. Thanks be to God. Thanks be to God. Let us pray. Patient God, when all our fury fizzles, you are still there. When our energy runs out, you are present, providing strength for the journey ahead. Fill us with the profound peace that only you can give, through the power of your Holy Spirit. Amen.
Thank you.
This week and for the following four Wednesdays, we gather in virtual Bible camp and get to share the highlights with you here in online worship. I was talking with Aaron Williams, who put these highlight reels together for us, and we decided there's no possible way to give you insight into every piece of this ministry unless you're there, but that we want to try at least to show you some of the ministry that you equip us to do with our children, who are so loved by God and our congregation. I want to give a sincere thanks to every single person who has a hand in helping me put our virtual Bible camp together. This year, our theme is Compassion Camp. And this week, our children learned that part of having compassion is learning to see and welcome each other. We learned about the story of the prodigal son, which is really about the father's love. We talked about the love of Jesus, too, that frees us from sin, and about how good it is to celebrate when people come home. One way we celebrate is, of course, with our favorite food. So I'd like to invite our children and every kid at heart to gather around. Welcome, everyone, to Compassion Camp. I am so excited that you are here. Thank you for making the time and having the energy to join us in this fun-filled 5 weeks of faith with old friends and new friends. We are so glad that you all are here. So can everybody get really close to their screen so I can see your faces? In order to show empathy, I need to see you. That's where compassion begins. I see your hurt. I feel your hurt. And I want to help ease your hurt. It's time for music class!
But we're gonna start with a hello song. So, my name is Mr. Badman. Welcome to music class. The most important rule of music class is that every noise that you make in music class is musical. That's my philosophy. So anything you do, you sing, when you sing, when you dance, when you do anything, it's all music to me, and I love it. All are welcome, friend and stranger, at the banquet of the Savior. All are welcome, all are welcome here.
Favorite food, Theo?
Mac and cheese and broccoli. I love mac and cheese.
My name is Mr. Ben, and I love pizza.
I'm Libby, and my favorite food is either sushi or mac and cheese.
My name's Gabby, and my favorite food is Mackinac Island bite.
Ooh. Good. Lily?
Cookie and strawberries.
He
likes cookies and strawberries.
Yeah. Yum. And does Brock have a favorite food?
Yes, he does.
It's
candy.
Candy. And my favorite food is
ice cream.
My name is Chloe and I like pancakes.
My name is Hannah.
Hi, Hannah. Welcome to Compassion Camp. And what's your favorite food?
My favorite food is plums.
Plums, yum.
Connor's running around because he just lost a tooth and he's too excited. And his favorite food is peanut butter and jelly.
Hazel?
Hey,
Hazel.
Hi, my name is Claire and my favorite food is
fish and chips. So, this is Hazel. His favorite food is spaghetti. Spaghetti. And I'm Liana. My favorite food
food is eat the stir fry.
And I like peanut butter and jelly.
Hi, my name is Mary, and I like either pancakes or ice cream.
Iris, can you share with us your favorite food, please?
Yeah.
What is that?
I love cheese pizza. Quinny.
Quinny, what's your favorite food?
Mac and
cheese.
Mac and cheese.
We continue now with the sharing of the word. There are some books and stories in the Bible that seem familiar by name, and so we think we may know them, when we may really not. I think the book of Job is one of those stories. I spent the last few weeks getting woke to Job, reading various translations, both ancient and modern, commentary after commentary, as well as some amazing poetry inspired by this ancient text. I thought I knew Job. Turns out there's so much more to the story. As Pastor Gary set the scene for our series on Job last week, he reminded us that the entire book addresses the question, why do bad things happen to good people? Well, today we take that question a bit further and ask, where is God when people suffer? As liberation theologian Gustavo Gutierrez writes, the book of Job does not claim to have found a rational or definitive explanation of suffering. It's a sacred text that leaves us with more questions than answers. The traditional moral of the story is that when you're faced with hard times, be like Job. Don't be tempted to relinquish your faith in God. God has reasons beyond our understanding for what God is doing. And if you hold on to your faith long enough, God will have compassion because of your resilience. If that makes you feel a certain way, I invite you to sit with those feelings for a moment while I read from the book of Job. But first, I'm going to play a recording of poet Maya Angelou reciting the poem The Slave Auction. And I invite you to consider that Job is also reciting poetry. The poetry in Job is called wisdom literature. Each voice of poetic justice reflects the truth of suffering in their own unique lived experience.
This poem is called The Slave Auction. It was written by Frances Ellen Watkins Harper, a Black lady poet writing in the 1850s. This was after she had seen an auction. The sale began. Young girls were there, defenseless in their wretchedness, whose stifled sobs and deep despair revealed the anguish of their breast. And women stood with streaming eyes and saw their dearest children sold. Unheeded rose their bitter cries, as tyrants bartered them for gold. And men whose sole crime was their hue, the impress of their maker's hand, and small and trembling children too were gathered in that mournful band. And women with their love and truth, for those in sable forms do dwell, gazed on the lovers of their youth with anguish none may paint nor tell. You who have laid your loves to rest and wept above that lifeless clay, know not the anguish of the breast whose loves are rudely torn away. The sale began.
A reading from Job. Job cries out, "What's the point of life?" Then Job broke his silence. He spoke up and cursed his fate. "Obliterate the day I was born, blank out the night I was conceived. Let it be a black hole in space. May God above forget it ever happened, erase it from the books. May the day of my birth be buried in deep darkness, shrouded by the fog, swallowed by the night. And the night of my conception, the devil take it. Rip the date off the calendar, delete it from the almanac. Oh, turn that night into pure nothingness. No sounds of pleasure from that night ever. May those who are good at cursing curse that day. Unleash the sea beast Leviathan on it. May its morning stars turn to black cinders, waiting for a daylight that never comes. Never once seeing the first light of dawn. And why? Because it released me from my mother's womb into a life with so much trouble." Then Eliphaz from Teman spoke up. "Would you mind if I said something to you? Under the circumstances, it's hard to keep quiet. You yourself have done this plenty of times, spoken words that clarify, encourage those who are about to quit. Your words have put stumbling people on their feet, put fresh hope in people about to collapse. But now you're the one in trouble. You are hurting. You've been hit hard and you're reeling from the blow. But shouldn't your devout life give you confidence now? Shouldn't your exemplary life give you hope? Think, has a truly innocent person ever ended up on the scrap heap? Do genuinely upright people ever lose out in the end? It's my observation that those who plow evil and sow trouble reap evil and trouble. One breath from God and they fall apart. One blast of God's anger and there's nothing left of them. The mighty lion, king of the beasts, roars mightily. But when he's toothless, he's useless. No teeth, no prey, and the cubs wander off to fend for themselves." And Job said, "So I'm not keeping one bit of this quiet. I'm laying it all out on the table. My complaining to high heaven is bitter but honest. Are you going to put a muzzle on me? The way you quiet the sea and still the storm? If I say I'm going to bed, then I'll feel better. A little nap will lift my spirits. You come and so scare me with nightmares and frighten me with ghosts that I'd rather strangle in the bedcloths than face this kind of life any longer. I hate this life. Who needs any more of this? Let me alone. There's nothing to my life. It's nothing but smoke. What are mortals, anyway, that you bother with them, that you even give them the time of day, that you check up on them every morning, looking in on them to see how they're doing? Let up on me, will you? Can't you even let me spit in peace? Even suppose I had sinned, how would that hurt you? You're responsible for every human being. Don't you have better things to do than pick on me? Why make a federal case out of me? Why don't you just forgive my sins and start me off with a clean slate? The way things are going, I'll soon be dead. You'll look high and low, but I won't be around." Word of God, word of life. Thanks be to God. Every year on June 17th, our church will commemorate the Honorable Emmanuel Nine, who were murdered in Bible study in their church building 5 years ago this week. During our prayer vigil on Wednesday, I shared a litany of remembrance for their vocations, prepared by our ELCA Office for Racial Justice and Equality. Some of that litany went like this. They were preachers. They were students and teachers. They were legislators. Open us, Lord, to receive the good news of Jesus. Kindle in us a desire to learn and grow in your ways. Inscribe on our hearts your laws of love and justice. But there was one line from this litany that really spoke to me in light of our reading from Job. It said this: they were poets. Reveal your truth in language we have yet to discover. The book of Job is a poetic narrative at the heart of which is suffering, justice, and hope. It wrestles with more than unjust suffering. The imagery and language within the text is at best problematic. It's a stark reminder that there is language we have yet to discover to talk about suffering and pain, darkness and blackness, and our willingness to remain in conversation with God and each other so that in the end, God's justice prevails above all else. Even with the various translations, study, and work that has been done with this one book in the Bible, one of the greatest takeaways is that we still have so much to learn, thanks be to God. The wisdom communicated in the book of Job is that we won't always get it right. We'll place blame unjustly and call out the sins of our brother before confronting our own. And yet, Job teaches us that if we remain open and honest in our communication with God and in our relationships with each other, we will continue to grow in faith and understanding. Now about Juneteenth, I had no idea. Growing up in the heart of Williamsburg, Virginia, I thought I had a decent education in American history. I lived in the colonial district. We took field trips multiple times a year to Jamestown and Yorktown. My life existed within the historic triangle of the United States. And until recently, I had no idea that there was one day dedicated to celebrating when slaves were granted their freedom. In 1865, 2.5 years after the Emancipation Proclamation was issued, I had unsafely assumed that the historical narrative which I was taught as a child was the only narrative there was. My education was and still is incomplete, and I have full confidence that I'm not alone. So in a way, I'm not surprised that I had no idea about Juneteenth. The fact that I was not exposed to a celebration that was meaningful to many Black people was yet another part of the majority narrative I was exposed to, one that gave priority and preference to the history of white people, not people of color, Black Americans, Native Americans, Palestinian Americans, or of women or any perceived minority. And I guess the same goes for the church. Our Bible is rich in themes of liberation, with stories of people of color leading and liberating the people of God. Moses, Jesus, and yes, Mary are a well-known few who were liberators to those enslaved by the love of power. Yet it's also steeped in slave narrative and inequitable language about darkness. Right down to the ways we write and talk about darkness and blackness in our liturgy, as well as what we read in Job chapter 3 today from the NRSV translation. Let the day perish in which I was born. Let that day be darkness. May God above not seek it or light shine on it. Let gloom and deep darkness claim it. Let the blackness of the day terrify it. What I've realized in my study of scripture is that language used in a variety of translations speaks to the perspective of the privileged few who were responsible for recording scripture. Remember, Job was writing for an elite Jewish crowd. And so we're wise to remember that if truth can stand questioning, It can also withstand multiple narratives being articulated and experienced. Why is this important? Because the way we proclaim the word has the power and ability to transform lives for better or worse. If we are truly going to live into our calling as children of God, unveiling truth in the name of Christ and seeking justice on behalf of those who innocently suffer like Job, then our narrative has got to change. The Black Lives Matter movement is exposing us to the language we need to continue changing our narrative and unveiling the truth about unjust suffering in this world. It's providing opportunities for education that help fill in the gaps of the incomplete stories we teach and tell. It's another valuable perspective about systemic racism that was never abolished with slavery. About Juneteenth, it's high time we, as the quote-unquote whitest church in America, start consistently lifting our voices in solidarity with our siblings of color. And keep working to change our poetic narrative, owning the sins of the past, and preparing a better way for our present and future lives together, for our children and their children's children to come. The good news is that we know the end of Job's narrative. We know God's intention for the people of God, created in the image of God for the glory of God. We have faith like Job that our Redeemer lives, and that freedom is the language of our God who liberated Christ from the cross for our sake. We know that love is embodied in the gift of human life that God created and called good for all people. Now, we need to live like it. Amen. Amen. You may already be familiar with the hymn we're about to hear. It's called Lift Every Voice and Sing. But did you know it's also known as the Black National Anthem and was written originally as a poem by NAACP leader James Weldon Johnson? Only later was it set to music by his brother John Rosamond Johnson in 1899. It was first performed in public in the Johnsons' hometown of Jacksonville, Florida, as part of a celebration of President Lincoln's birthday on February 12, 1900, by a choir of 500 school children at the segregated Stanton School where James Weldon Johnson was principal.
Every voice and sing.
in unity with the whole church, let us confess our faith with the words of the Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the dead. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father, and he will come to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. At this time of the offering, we give thanks to God and to you for your continued support of ministries in our congregation and wider church. The offerings we give help keep ministries going that provide aid for people in a time of crisis and that help enrich our lives of faith. There are a list of ways on the screen that you can continue your giving through tithes and offerings. You can use the donate button on our website, mail in your offering to the church, or set up direct deposit. Will you join me in the offering prayer? Let us pray. We are not always grateful for the gifts you provide, and yet we can be faithful through our giving and service, trusting that you bless the offerings of our hearts and use them for your greater purpose, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our offering hymn is Leaning on the Everlasting Arms, sung by ULC's New Hope Singers at our Outdoor Worship Expressions Gospel Revival Service. Let's join together in prayer, mindful that the prayer response is receive our prayer.
We pray for the church, the world, and all those in need. As with Job, you allow us freedom to express the pain and rage of our grief and disappointment with life. Your love is not threatened by the ways we diminish, marginalize, and destroy each other. Hold us fast no matter what we say or do, and assure us of your unwavering presence in all circumstances. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. Within the scope of your vast universe, we humans are only a speck, and yet you know and care for each one of us as your children. You have made your faithfulness known from generation to generation. We thank you for the unfathomable way in which you have made and continue to sustain us. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. Be with all who feel their own bodies have turned against them, suffering with extreme physical pain and affliction. Give them balm for their suffering and comfort from friends and loved ones. Be with those whose particular needs we know today: Kim, Joseph, Carl, Ed, Sarah, Michael, Bruce, Norm, Harry, Melissa, Mark, Susan, and Marilyn. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. We give thanks for the gift of those who have fathered well, whether they happen to be our biological fathers or not. We acknowledge the hurt of those who have not been fathered well and sit beside them. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. In remembering the day in which the slaves in Texas finally heard of their emancipation, we cry out to you to bring all slavery to an end. Bring an end to the enslavement of children as soldiers. Bring an end to the trafficking of women and children as objects for sexual abuse. Bring an end to enslavement and transportation of people across borders to work in factories, fields, and construction sites. While the visible slavery of centuries past is no longer, our enslavement and abuse of others continues. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. Call us into a deeper relationship to be your church for the sake of the world. Help us to see the injustices within church and society and how we contribute to them. Call us to uplift the humanity and dignity of every person. Help us to listen to and learn from the experiences of people of color. Call us to join with others to work for racial equity and inclusion for all people. Help us to speak up and about the injustices we continue to perpetrate against each other. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. Where hearts are fearful and constricted, grant courage and hope. Where anxiety is infectious and widening, grant peace and reassurance. Where impossibilities close every door and window, grant imagination and resistance. Where distrust twists our thinking, grant healing and illumination. Where spirits are daunted and weakened, grant soaring wings and strengthened dreams. Steadfast God, receive our prayer. You are faithful as the passing of endless generations, O Lord. May these prayers be a beginning of the fulfillment of your will on the earth, and may we also be used for your holy purposes. In Jesus' name, amen.
At this time, we ask for any of your prayer requests you may have. You can make those in your hearts or in the comment section on our live Facebook video. We pray for all those who live in isolation, especially those who live alone and long for company. We pray for those experiencing great loss. For Matt in critical condition at U of M. We give you thanks, O Lord, for celebrations like Juneteenth that remind us of the precious gift of freedom you desire for all of your people. We pray for all those who work tirelessly in difficult times and for those who long to be able to work again. We pray for strained family relationships, and we pray for Brittany to get well. We pray for safe travels for those visiting loved ones they've not seen in months. You are faithful as the passing of endless generations, O Lord. May these prayers be a beginning of the fulfillment of your will on the earth. And may we also be used for your holy purposes. In Jesus' name, amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Give us today our daily bread. Forgive us our sins as we forgive those who sin against us. Save us from the time of trial and deliver us from evil. For the kingdom, the power, and the glory are yours, now and forever. Amen. May you receive this blessing with an open heart. May the Lord bless and keep you. May God's face shine upon you. And be gracious and give you peace. Amen. Thank you again for sending us your photos of fathers. Aaron Williams put together this beautiful presentation to recognize all of the love and guidance they give. Thank you for leading by example.
It's only for a moment you were mine to hold. The plans that heaven has for you will all too soon unfold. So many different prayers I'll pray for all that you might do. But most of all I wanna know you're walking in the truth. And if I never told you, I want you to know that as I watch you grow, I pray that God would fill your heart with dreams, and that faith gives you the courage to dare. You find your wings. May passion be the wind that leads you through your days, and may conviction keep you strong, guide you on your way. May there be many moments that make your life so. Faith gives you the courage to dare.
Go in peace. Share the freedom of Christ. Thanks be to God.